Hello and welcome to the darkened room of music conversation.
Hello everyone, I'm Darren.
Nice to meet you, Darren. I'm Chris.
Nice to meet you.
Welcome to the show. Today we're going to touch on, well, for a couple episodes, we're going to talk about the world of disco.
Cool.
Now, lots of documentaries have been made on disco. You know, it's been talked about to death. A lot of people already know the history and its demise. It's already been covered.
Sure.
What we're going to talk about is the influence that disco had on the rock and roll world.
All right.
Yeah, and for about 15 minutes and millions of dollars,
it
dropped off just about as quick as it started.
Sure did.
And before we start, we want to invite you to subscribe to the channel. Yeah. Click like on the video. If you have anything to contribute after hearing our take on this, drop it in the comments. We'd love to hear from you.
All right, let's get it.
All right, let's get into it, man.
I think everyone would agree that one of the most pivotal moments in the whole disco era was the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. I mean, yes. You took a band like the Bee Gees, who were already well-respected in the music community, and they went full-on disco.
Yeah.
Starting with Jive Talkin', I think that was the moment.
Great song.
Amazing song that holds up so well. But I think a lot of musicians looked around and was like, you know what? The Bee Gees did this, and it was good.
Yeah.
It wasn't lame. And so even before that, you started seeing and hearing some of the disco stylings within rock and roll music.
True.
And I'll give you a few examples. Probably the earliest one I can think of was the Electric Light Orchestra, a band that's dear and dear to me, with Evil Woman. I think that you can hear some disco elements in that song.
Certainly.
Absolutely. Boz Scaggs' Lowdown, you know, the disco beat. In that song, Jeff Beccaro playing the drums, amazing song.
Yeah.
Steely Dan, the Fez. If you never heard that, and Steely Dan, once again, one of my favorite groups of all time. A lot of disco in that song.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of, it's almost an instrumental, but there's a little bit of vocal passages in throughout the song, but it's very disco sounding. Yeah. The Atlanta Rhythm Section, So Into You. I love that song.
Yeah.
It's basically a rock song. It's got a guitar solo and everything, but it has that disco feel.
It does, yeah. Even though it's a slower song,
yeah,
it's got that beat to it.
Yeah, just that whole driving and the hi-hat and all that stuff. Another song from around the same time was the Alan Parsons Project. I Wouldn't Want to Be Like You.
Yeah.
I mean, you're talking about giving your cymbals and your hi-hats a working out.
Yeah.
I mean, that thing was straight up a disco beat.
It was.
Now, all of this predated the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack. So, even before that, you had bands, you know, just dabbling a little bit here and there with the disco sound.
So, not long after the Saturday Night Fever soundtrack just exploded on the scene, some of the biggest rock bands in the world started to dabble into the disco sound.
Yeah.
And we're going to touch on several examples that we think are the most shining examples. Big bands such as the Rolling Stones.
All right.
Yeah. So the song Miss You, which was released in
1978.
There we go. All right, maybe I shouldn't say dabbling. They were going full head on into it.
Absolutely.
And even some of the stories that recounted by some band members would suggest that they weren't fully invested into it. But come on. I mean, you
know. Just listen to it, right?
Money talks, as AC/DC once said.
Right.
So for the Rolling Stones, the song actually came to be when Mick Jagger was jamming with Billy Preston during a rehearsal.
That's amazing. I never knew that till you brought that to my attention. That's a great story.
Yeah. So the other band members, you know, insisted that Miss You was not conceived as a disco song. Yeah.
Come on.
Keith Richards said that Miss You was a damn good disco record.
Yeah, they knew it was disco.
He said it was calculated to be one.
Right.
There you go. Charlie Watts commented on it as well. He said that a lot of those songs like Miss You were heavily influenced by going to the discos.
Yeah.
So there you go.
Studio 54 vibes, right?
That's right. So in spite of what some of the other band members may say, they meant to do that.
Yeah, and you know the other thing was that the song was 9 minutes long originally. They edited it down to the 5.5 minutes or 5:40 or whatever it ended
up being on the record.
That's true,
yeah.
And the original 9-minute version, you had to get on a 12-inch disc.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
Yeah. A lot of people may not remember that or are old enough to know, most of the original disco songs were really long.
Really long.
That's how they constructed them.
Yeah. Yeah. And so they would edit them down to the single versions.
Of course.
But I love the full 9-minute version. I think it's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a great song.
Yes.
So Miss You actually went to number one for the Rolling Stones. So it definitely paid off for them.
Incredible.
Huge dollar signs. Now, there were some other rock and roll artists who weren't really so much into the disco scene, and they were kind of wanting to poke fun at it.
Yeah.
As an example, Rod Stewart's Do You Think I'm Sexy? Now, that's definitely a straight-up disco song.
All the way.
Yeah. So, Dwayne Hutchins noted that Do You Think I'm Sexy was a spoof on guys from the Cocaine Lounge Lizards of the Saturday Night Fever days.
Wow.
Yeah, he said that we rock and roll guys thought we were dead meat when that movie and the Bee Gees, you know, came out and were so successful.
Yeah.
Yeah. But he said now the Bee Gees were brilliant musicians. He did give them credit for
That's
that.
That's what I was saying.
Absolutely. And very nice people.
Yeah.
So he didn't necessarily dislike them.
Right.
It's like no big egos, but Rod, in his brilliance, let me get the quote exactly right, decided to do a spoof on disco. Very smart man, he said. There's no such thing as a dumb super success in the music business.
And you gotta understand too, at this time, Rod Stewart was like the premier lead singer of rock and roll. Him and Mick Jagger. If you had to say one and two, and I'm not sure which order would be right, it's those two guys.
Yeah.
And looky here. They're both doing disco songs.
Absolutely. And, you know, it turned out to be a pretty brilliant choice because Do You Think I'm Sexy spent 4 weeks at number one on the Billboard Hot 100.
And I'm old enough to remember that song got played in the ground.
Yeah.
That, you know,
another
what?
One of those songs you just could not get away from.
And it may be, I would have to think hard about this, that may be the first song I ever got sick of.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I got sick of that song as a kid. Like, I didn't want to hear it.
Yeah. I'd have to think long and hard about what that song is. That might be another episode.
It could be. Yeah. I'm giving too much away.
So another highly respected, well-regarded band from this era was Blondie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And they brought out Heart of Glass.
Let me guess. It went number one.
Yeah, actually it did. In several countries.
Really? Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Totally did. Yeah.
I see a theme here.
Yeah. So, yeah, with Blondie, you know, you think about them. They actually did a lot of dancey stuff. But you got to remember where they came from. They came more out of the rock / punk world.
Yeah.
Think of the song One Way or Another.
Yeah.
That was more who they were in the very, very beginning. Or so we think. One of the first songs that they actually recorded was Heart of Glass.
Really?
Yeah, and that original demo was called Once I Had Love. And they just kept it on the back burner, and it wasn't until 79 that they brought it out.
And how old was the song?
It was 74, 75 when they recorded that.
Okay, so it's like a 5-year-old song by that point.
Yeah,
wow.
Yeah.
So never knew that.
They referred to it as the disco song. So they actually intentionally recorded it as a disco song, and it was originally inspired by the Hughes Corporation Rock the Boat.
I love that song.
Side note, that's the first song that I truly have a memory of as a kid.
Really?
Yeah.
Cool.
Totally. So cool. I remember my dad had the 45 of that. So
nice.
And as far back as I can remember, it's got to be that one.
I have the 45 of that.
Very cool. Yeah. So as a band, you know, Blondie had experimented with disco before, kind of harkening back to my earlier point. You know, when they performed live, they actually would do some cover songs of big disco hits. And Debbie Harry expressed her affinity for the Euro disco music of Giorgio Moroder.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Stating that it's commercial, but it's good. It says something. That's the kind of stuff that I want to do.
Yeah. So Giorgio, known for his work with Donna Summer, of course.
That's right. And speaking of Donna Summer, when Blondie played for the Johnny Blitz benefit in May 78, they surprised everyone with a cover of Donna Summer's I Feel Love.
Oh, wow. So they were already dabbling with the idea of doing disco.
That's right. And some people consider it like the first time, arguably, in New York, in the middle of the great rock versus disco split, that a rock band had played a disco song.
Okay.
Yeah. So you see, it was kind of already in their roots, in their veins. They kind of wanted to do more stuff like that.
Yeah.
And it was an intentional.
Yeah. And you got to remember, once again, as you pointed out brilliantly, you know, they were a very well-respected band. So at this point in time, it you know, the clock was running out on disco. No one knew it at this point.
Yeah.
They were very influential and respected bands, full on embracing disco.
Totally.
Yeah. Even if just for one song.
That's right. Now, back in this era, think of the most rock and roll band that was hugely popular back then, and you think of Kiss.
For sure.
Of all bands to go disco, you would think they'd be the last to do it, you know? But they did.
Yeah.
I Was Made for Loving You.
And I'm going to tell you right now, I think that song kicks ass. There's something that drives. I love that song.
It's a good song.
I think it's amazing. And in retrospect, I probably love it even more.
Wow.
I really do.
Yeah.
I think it's great. I do not mind hearing it. And I think it's a great song from a great album.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you know, Desmond Child, I believe, was a co-writer on that.
That's right.
He said Paul wanted to write a good disco song. And I decided to help him with that.
Now, Desmond Child was also a member of Desmond Child and Rouge, which did do disco pop stylings and everything. So I guess that's why Paul wanted to write with him.
Yeah, yeah. Now, there's a bit of a mystery behind this as far as what actually happened.
Yeah.
According to legend, the members of the band were in conflict with the with their producers, who wanted the band to shift to a more commercial sound. In response, the band argued that lucrative disco songs could be written by anyone in a short time frame. The story goes that the song's demo was completed a mere hours after that bet. And, you know, that story's unproven.
Yeah.
But now Paul Stanley did say that it was a conscious effort on his part to prove how easy it was to write and record a hit disco song. Yeah, so there's some truth to that.
I've heard him say that. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, on this track, Peter Criss, he appears in the video, but he didn't actually play drums on the track, and many of the tracks on that album.
Right.
It was Anton Figg who took his place.
Yeah, Peter was a mess at that point. Anton, a brilliant drummer. Many know him from Late Night with David Letterman, being the house drummer on
That's right, yeah.
And also had the Kiss affiliation, because he played with Ace Frehley after Ace had left Kiss. He was in Frehley's Comet.
So Kiss doing a big disco song, you'd think there'd be a big backlash, went to number 11 on the Billboard Hot 100.
Yeah, and it was a huge song. I remember it being played just as much as, like, maybe not as Do You Think I'm Sexy, but Heart of Glass and songs like that. It got played a lot.
It did, yeah. You couldn't get away from it. So probably the best example of them all, and the biggest example of it really paying off for the band. Talk about Queen.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Another One Bites the Dust. Yeah, this one of my favorite Queen songs for sure.
Same here.
Yeah. John Deacon's bass line in this song was actually inspired by Good Times by Chic.
And you can totally hear it.
That's right. Chic co-founder Bernard Edwards stated that Queen record came about because the Queen bass player spent some time hanging out with us at our studio.
Yeah.
So he got influenced just by knowing the guys.
Yeah.
John Deacon said that he listened to a lot of soul music when he was in school. Always been interested in that sort of music. And he'd been wanting to do a track like that and for a long time.
Yeah.
The song got picked up off the album. And some of the black radio stations in the U.S. started playing it, which they've never had happen before.
Right. Yeah. Right.
And Michael Jackson is actually, we can give him credit for this, for it even being a single. He's the one that suggested it.
Cool. I love that story.
It was like the third single released from the album.
Yeah.
So it was kind of like an afterthought.
Wow.
Yeah. Can you imagine that not even being part of pop culture?
I know it was a massive, massive hit. How big was it, in fact?
Okay. Well, I'll give you some notes here.
Yeah.
Number one on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100 for 3 weeks. 13 weeks in the top 10, which was the longest running top 10 song of 1980. 13 weeks in the top 5, 31 weeks total on the chart.
That's amazing.
More than any other song in 1980.
So the biggest hit of 1980, as I was like to me.
The biggest hit of 1980 was Another One Bites the Dust.
Very cool.
Yeah. Now, Roger in the band, you know, he wasn't really on board with this song. Brian May is quoted saying that Roger at the time certainly felt that it wasn't rock and roll and was quite angry at the way it was going. Yeah, and Freddie had turned to him and said, "Darling, leave it to me. I believe in this."
Yeah, and I'm sure he had no problem cashing those checks down the road either.
Yeah.
Selling out all those stadiums and everything. Yeah. But, you know, it kind of makes sense. Roger being the drummer in the band, mm-hmm. he was kind of more the punk kind of guy with the rock and roll attitude, you
right.
know?
Yeah.
So I could see him kind of showing some resistance. But like I said, I'm sure when it bought him a house, he didn't mind.
Right, yeah. So, you know, John had written the song, and it was Freddie's support that made it happen.
Very cool.
Yeah. And what a payoff it was.
So near the end of the decade of the 70s, so many examples of rock bands going, at least doing one song here or there in disco. Mm-hmm. It happened so frequently. Another one that kind of had the stylings of disco somewhat was Pink Floyd, Another Brick in the Wall.
That's right, yeah. And this wasn't really a conscious effort by the band. This was kind of guided by the producer, Bob Ezrin.
Yeah.
He was the one that kind of came up with this idea. And even Incognito recorded some of the bass tracks of it without telling certain members of the band. Yeah. Eventually, they jumped on board and, you know, it went to number one.
Yeah.
So it paid off for them, too.
A number one hit. It's just amazing.
Yeah.
Heart, Straight On. I love that song.
I do, too.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just got such a groove. And, you know, there's a fine line between, you know, R&B and groovy groove music and disco. But definitely, I think the disco influence is in that song.
Yeah, absolutely.
Toto, Georgie Porgy, another song I absolutely love.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely had the disco stylings in there. ELO. They did a whole record. I mean, the Discovery record. Hello.
Yeah.
Very disco.
That's
disco
right.
Very. There was Shine a Little Love, which I think is an incredible song. And Last Train to London, which basically lifts the bass line of Boogie Nights verbatim.
There you go.
And it's just a great song.
Yeah.
Wet Willie. Here's a southern rock band of all things.
Yeah.
The song Weekend charted. Made it into the top 40.
Yeah.
Once again, a disco song.
A fond memory of me on that was the 5 o'clock whistle. They would play that every Friday at 5 o'clock.
Yeah, and that was 107, right?
I believe it was 107
here locally in Nashville. Yeah. So, yeah. Mm-hmm. Chicago didn't have a lot of success with this one. Actually, it kind of killed their career at the time. Street Player. Mm-hmm. And I think it was one of the last albums they released on CBS before they jumped over to Warner Brothers.
Yeah.
But once again, they tried a disco song. Elton did a few. Victim of Love being the one that was most prominently disco, in my opinion. Didn't hit real well. I wasn't that crazy about that song, but once again, we're talking Elton John, an artist I adore.
Yeah.
And he's like, hey, disco's all right. Now, this is the most unique one in the whole batch right
this
here.
Surprised me.
Yeah. And we listened to it earlier. We were giggling. Come on.
Yeah.
The Grateful Dead did a disco song.
They did. It was called Shakedown Street.
And it's actually pretty cool.
It actually is.
I liked it a lot.
It's probably my favorite Grateful Dead song ever.
Yeah. Yeah. I can't wait to read those comments in the comments section.
Bring it.
The Kinks, Superman. And I didn't really dig that one too much, but definitely their attempt at a disco song.
Yeah.
Jethro Tull, of all the bands out there.
Right.
Warm Saran. That was another disco type song that they tried out. You know, why not? Everybody else is doing it.
Yeah.
Ringo Starr, Tango All Night.
That's right. A Beatle.
We've got more than one Beatle. We also had The Wings, Paul McCartney, Good Night Tonight.
That's right.
And I love that song. I think that song's incredible. I love the bass line. And if you have a chance to hear the extended mix of that one, it is so good.
Cool.
And then finally, another one I wanted to mention. This was a total disaster.
Do we have to bring this one up?
I guess we do. And there's more than these.
Yeah, sometimes it didn't work out for these bands.
Right. Now, this is coming on the heels of them signing a mega, mega contract with Columbia or CBS or Sony or whoever it was. I don't remember which subsidiary.
Yeah.
But the Beach Boys tried their own disco song, Here Comes the Night. Don't go there.
No.
You don't want to hear it. It really is awful. And I love the Beach Boys.
If you have any affinity for your ears, don't Google this one.
And you know, the only thing that could have made it worse was to make it more than 11 minutes.
It was 11 minutes long, yes. It was 11 minutes. You know, we make a habit not to bash, you know, music on this channel.
I love the Beach Boys.
I do too, yeah. And, you know, a lot of this is in jest, but
yeah,
it really isn't that good.
That song was a turd. It was really bad.
Yeah.
It was really bad. So there you go. There you have it. So, mm-hmm. and not long after this, sometime in 79, that's when they had the big, the night at the baseball stadium in Chicago where the
everybody. Disco Sucks event, yeah.
Yeah, bring all your disco records. We'll blow them up. We'll burn them. We're going to do away with disco. Now, you got to remember, there were stations at this point in time that switched to all disco.
Yeah.
There were stretches in the 70s where for months on end, the number one songs back to back to back to back to back were all disco songs.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was a really, really glorified, huge form of music at this point.
It really was. And a lot of people credit that event as the absolute death of disco. It went away overnight. When we did an episode on 1992, how a lot of music historians kind of consider grunge doing the same thing to the hair metal movement. And it really wasn't the case.
No.
So this event at the stadium, it wasn't the case either. So in a future episode, we're going to talk about what happened after that event at the stadium and how disco began to morph and change and influence a lot of the sounds you heard in the 80s.
So it didn't completely go away.
Not completely, yeah. It definitely left its mark.
Correct.
Yeah. And disco really deserves more credit than people give it now. I mean, there has been a recent resurgence of popularity of disco.
Yeah.
Like, even here in Nashville, there's several disco events nearly every weekend. You know, bars will have a disco night. I thought I would never see that day.
You know, it's funny, because when I think about disco, I think there was a lot of crap in the disco era. I'm just going to be honest. And and I'm not a big fan of a lot of it.
Yeah.
And, you know, how many songs...
Well, you didn't like Disco Duck?
I did like Disco Duck. That's the most ironic freaking thing in the world. I like Disco Duck. Yeah. I think that song's funny as hell.
Yeah.
But what I'm trying to say is that a lot of the songs, you know, subject matter wise, are pretty lame and pretty shallow. You know, how many songs can you do about boogie and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, you're talking about that boogie oogie oogie and all that stuff.
Stuff like that.
And the hustle.
But what I was gonna say regarding like rock and roll songs, and I think that this is kind of true in other genres too, and I will expand my thought process on this. I think when you don't know the rules of something, you tend to do a better job with it. So in other words, these rock and roll bands that really didn't care a whole lot about disco or know a whole lot about it, they were able to take it kind of in different areas because they really didn't know what the rules were.
Yeah, you had to throw a little creativity into it to fill in the gaps, and you get a product that's better.
I've always said that when groups that aren't heavy do a heavy song, a lot of times it's better because they don't know what the rules are. They're not thinking of, is this metal enough? Is this heavy metal? You know, they just do it.
That's right.
And so I think a lot of these songs hold up better than actual disco songs for that reason.
I would agree with that. And what do you think? Drop it down in the comments. Let us know. Click like on the video. And let's play some trivia.
Let's do it.
All right. All right. Let's test our knowledge with the trivia box.
What's the chances that we're going to get a disco question?
You know, every time you say that, and typically it's not the case.
It never happens.
Yeah. All right. So the category is, it might be close. It's the 80s.
Okay.
So let's see what the question is.
This is a home run. We're going to get it right. I can tell you that.
David Bowie's, no, that's not disco. Except Fame. He kind of touched disco with Fame a little bit.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah.
Okay. So David Bowie's 1983 hit, Let's Dance, featured which legendary guitarist?
Yeah, Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Very easy.
Yeah, Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Stevie Ray Vaughan. But the other choice, this is kind of funny, Jerry Garcia is a choice. How do you list Jerry Garcia with Stevie Ray Vaughan as far as guitar virtuosos go?
You know,
how does that happen?
He's a better guitar player than you think, though.
Yeah, maybe he really is. Look at that. I've stabbed at Grateful Dead twice in one episode.
Yeah.
It's like I'm painting my own target on my forehead here.
Yes, you are.
I don't disrespect the Grateful Dead, okay?
But you know what? Okay, I got a question for you. Let's Dance, is that an example of a song that morphed from out of disco? I think yes.
I think it is. Yeah.
So this is related.
It is. It actually is.
That's a great example of a song that morphed out of that kind of styling.
Very good example. And that's a little preview for the next episode. Yeah. So there you go. Join us for that. It'll be along very soon.
And if you want to watch the episode that Chris referred to about 1991, 92.
Yep. right there. Click on that.
Yes.
All right. We'll see you next time, guys. Take care.